Welcome to Live and Sort of on the Loose. My name is Frankie, this is Stephanie. We have a couple really exciting animals to show everyone today, but before we get started, we'd just like to cover a couple safety topics. We are working with live venomous reptiles today, so we would appreciate it if at this time everyone silenced their cell phones. It would minimize our distractions greatly. And also, if we could limit the discussion amongst each other while we're working with the animals, we'd also appreciate that. Flash photography is A-okay. The most important safety thing we need to discuss are these two barriers. At the very end of the program, we're going to invite everyone up to the barriers for a close look, pictures, questions, yada yada, about the animals. We only ask that you do not lean on or over either of these two barriers. The distance is thought out to keep you at a safe distance from the animal, and they do not hold our weight very well, the barriers, so if you lean on them, you might get a much closer look at the animal than you had initially intended, and that's not very fun for anyone. So just keep that in mind. Do not lean on or over those when the time comes. And I believe we covered the boring stuff, so. Are we ready to get started?
Yeah.
I kind of butchered that question, but I think the answer could be a little bit better. Right, guys, are ready to get started?
Yeah!
That's the answer I like to see. Well, venomous reptiles, what's the first animal we think of when we hear those two words? Rattlesnakes, sure, iconic. Well, we're going to start off with a different animal, actually. This is a venomous lizard. It's the only venomous lizard in the United States. Anyone want to shout out their guess as to who's about to join us on the table?
Gila monster.
Bingo, the Gila monster. Now on three, we're all going to say ooh and ah, right? One, two, three.
Ooh.
Look at this handsome gentleman. This is an adult male Gila monster. And maybe our first impression, for those of us up close, is that's a pretty bumpy lizard. And they are. Their appearance kind of gave their name to the family that they're classified in, which would be translated into the beaded lizard family. Go figure. Each of these little bumps are actually little bones called osteoderms that are in their skin. And when we get an x-ray of a Gila monster, we can see all those polka dots. The bones show up very clearly. Osteoderms. Ooh, ah. let's see, what else can we talk about their appearance? Well, you know, before their appearance, let's talk about the range a little bit. They're kind of special to the Southwest, right? We're spoiled. No one else in the world gets to live alongside these types of lizards. Except, of course, a little bit down in New Mexico, where we have their cousin species. But in the United States, they occur in Arizona, a little bit in our neighboring states as well, and like I said, down into Sonora. Well, let's talk about his appearance a little bit. He's feeling pretty relaxed. It makes my job a little easier. Although you guys might appreciate it if you went flying through the air into my chest or something. Well, I wouldn't appreciate it. So let's see, the dark part of the face there, they do have a set of eyes with eyelids. Their vision's fair, okay, they can't really see way off into the distance. They are predators, so you think, well, if a predator has this short-term or a short-distance vision, that might be a disadvantage, right? Not really. The Gila monster spends a lot of their time in cracked areas. For example, they'll spend up to about 95% of their life underground. You don't need to see very far underground, right? Usually means tight little burrows and crevices and whatnot, so their vision serves them pretty well. They do have ears. None of these funky things like we've got, but they have holes in their head. And what those ears are really tuned to picking up on are higher-pitched squeaky noises. Remember that for about a minute from now. It is relevant. My favorite sense of the Gila monster is that I like to pick him up in the air because he uses him a little more when he's airborne. Not heading out my chest, of course. But what do we see happening in the front of his face there?
Tongue's coming
out. That tongue is doing some work. He's not mocking you guys, is he? I like to think we give him a little bit better manners training than to stick his tongue out at you. But he's smelling, right? That's what he's actually doing. It's kind of like a super sense of smell when they flick that tongue. Every time they flick the tongue, it samples the air and the surfaces that it comes into contact with. And when they withdraw the tongue back into the mouth, it comes in contact with a specialized organ in the roof of the mouth called the Jacobson's organ. And that information is delivered to the brain, pressing a heightened sense of smell, essentially. One thing that's really worth noting about their tongue is that it's forked. Well, what does this mean? It's not just giving it a villainous look, I guess, right? We all think of a forked tongue and go, ooh, that creature must be something nightmarish. Well, it actually has a purpose. The fork in the tongue kind of gives them a directional sense of smell. Because when they're flicking their tongue, they get two samples, right? So when they get that information, they can think, it smells delicious this way, or it smells terrifying that way. they can adjust their path accordingly, right? Well, this is a predator, and I did say they're listening for squeaky sounds, high-pitched sounds. So, let's talk about their diet. What do we think this Gila monster will be looking for on the menu that makes squeaky, high-pitched sounds?
Mice.
Mice, great guess. Any other guesses? Okay, we'll go with mice. I like mice. Well, I like to classify them with two words, really. Nest raiders. Maybe that's why they're called monsters, right? They're going to the nurseries, I guess, of the other animals. This is not a fast animal. He might be a little lazy right now, but they don't get much more active than this. So they're not going to be able to chase down a pack rat or anything like that. They have to go and look for eggs and other prey items that can't really escape them. So nest raiders. Oh, hello. Have I caught your attention? I think you want to be looking this way. You guys want to see his face, right?
Yeah.
It's more interesting than the rear end. So a little bit more about these their habits when they find these nests. They actually are a little bit of a glutton. The Gila monster can eat quite a large serving of food. This animal can easily eat one-third of their body weight in one sitting. I like to put my weight in that equation and see what kind of dinner I come up with. Mildly terrifying, but I have yet to accomplish it anyway. Another extreme that we like to talk about in their eating habits is how few meals it would take to sustain this lizard. Well, I like to do this part as a survey. By show of hands, who thinks this lizard must eat every day? Awesome, we're off to a great start. I like when I see no hands to that question. What about once a week? A couple hands here and there, all right. How about once a month? Who thinks once a month? Ooh, that's the warm area, right? What about once every 6 months? Ooh. And now the brave and the bold. What about once a year? You guys are crazy. You could eat once a year and be okay with that? Oh, man.
Once a year.
Well, really, the bottom figure that we like to give is about 3 meals a year.
Wow.
This lizard can live off of that. That's pretty impressive, right? Yeah, wow. No, no thanks. I'll pass. I like the human habits better. Well, like 3 times a day for us. How is that more of like what we're used to? Well, one of the ways they're able to accomplish this is with this fancy tail that he's got back there. Kind of acts like a pantry. When they eat those big meals, they metabolize a lot of their food into fat and water, and it kind of goes into storage in their little pantry area, I guess you could say. So when they're going through those times of the year where they're not actually eating or times are tough, you know, they can pull from that reserve and keep going. So they're kind of masters of their metabolism in that way. This way. There we go. So yeah, that's really the short story about their diet is Gila monsters eat babies, right? Kind of freaky, but that's what they do. They're specialized predators. Well, let's stick with the word babies for a second. Let's talk about their babies. I'm going to start off by saying they're absolutely adorable. If any of you are fortunate enough to ever see a tiny Gila monster, it's essentially a scaled-down adult Gila monster. They hatch out fully venomous and ready to take on the world, and I say hatch. They do lay eggs, and they lay about between two and a dozen per clutch. And initially, the female has an easier role in the reproduction cycle. The female will kind of hang back and release a pheromone into the air. Kind of acts like a perfume. So she waits for the boys to show up and react to the perfume, right? Well, sometimes multiple boys will show up. Now, we have our ways of dealing with these types of things. They have theirs. The way that they like to settle it is with a wrestling match, essentially. The Gila monsters will engage in a wrestling match for rights to the female. Now, they don't bite each other, they won't use their venom, they don't really claw or seek to injure each other or kill each other at all. It's just they want to exhaust each other. And it can get pretty exhausting. They've observed some of these wrestling matches to go on and off for about 10 hours.
Wow.
Yeah, impressive. So what can we infer here? Female Gila monsters are something special, right? We can all agree on that. 10 hours. Wow. Well, so yeah, the loser will go, the winner will go to the female. They'll do their thing, and the male takes off. He's done. About 6 to 8 weeks later, the female will be ready to lay her eggs, and she'll choose a really secure spot underground to deposit those eggs. She'll do so, and then she'll take off. Please hold your applause for the parents of the year. Sounds like they're doing a bang-up job, but they actually are. It works for them. Like I said, she chooses as secluded and safe a location as she can to put those eggs. Now, something fascinating about the development of these babies in the egg is we don't exactly know when they're typically hatching in the wild. There's two possibilities, really. The bottom line is that the babies will emerge the following season, because the eggs are laid about July, August, so about 9 months later we see the babies come to the surface, but one of the possibilities is that the babies will hatch in the fall of the first year, and they'll wait underground in the nest with the eggs until the following spring, and then they'll emerge to the surface, so they kind of just go straight into a hibernation, if you will. The other possibility is that the incubation will kind of reach a pause, so they'll temporarily pause in their development in the eggs, and then the development will finish up and they'll hatch the following spring and immediately emerge to the surface. So those are kind of the things that we're still figuring out with them, because like I said, they're really secretive animals. You know, their total surface activity can be only up to 3 weeks a year. You know, that's a one figure that was actually reported for some of the wild Gila monsters' surface activity. So very secretive animals. Let's see, what else about the reproduction? I did mention that the babies hatch out venomous, right? That's one thing that I like to make sure I say. Let's see. And they hatch out about 5.5 inches on average. And yeah, so that's kind of the story of where the baby Gila monsters come from. No parental care, I know, parents of the year. Well, at this point, I'm kind of wondering, this is a venomous lizard, and we talked about their diet, their predators, we talked about their breeding, but we really have yet to see the use of venom at all, right? We haven't seen that. So, where do we think the Gila monster's venom truly shines for it? In what part of its life? When would we see it use its venom? Here's your hint. Yes?
Defense.
Self-defense. Bingo. It's a defensive mechanism that the Gila monster has, and it's a good one. It's a great teaching tool. We don't really regard Gila monster venom as immediately lethal to humans. It can be. People have died from Gila monster bites. Last reported death, depending on the source you consult, was about 100 years ago. Not really frequent that people are dropping from Gila monster bites. We get about 12 to 15 bites a year. But what these bites are incredibly painful. That's what we do know. Everyone who's bitten by a Gila monster has found a new ceiling for what they can define as human pain, right? It's very painful, and it's immediate. The effects of the venom, as soon as the venom is introduced into the animal that it so graciously bites onto, the effects are immediate, and the pain intensifies from that moment forward, and it can last from between 12 and 24 hours. What a day. Those are the three words that float across my mind, because literally it can be your entire day will be spent coping with the effects of this venom. Now, we can really talk about all the horror stories and statistics about Gila monster bites, but this is an animal that we can all agree that accidents don't really happen, right? Look at how slow he is. He's not flying through the air chasing anyone. I like to really leave it at this. This is an animal that if you were out hiking in their habitat and you stumbled into one, this is more than enough distance for you both to continue enjoying your day. So, really with Gila monsters, the bottom line is don't touch them, right? Not to be over simple about anything, but that's really what it boils down to with these animals. Accidents don't really happen. People that get bit by Gila monsters are thinking, what a slowpoke. I think I could pick this guy up and get a sweet picture for my Instagram. Well, they're fooled with how quickly these animals can turn around. If I were to grab this animal suddenly by its hindquarters, it'll suddenly grab me right back. That's one thing they are pretty fast at, is doubling right back around and grabbing you back. So, if you, I know nobody here is ever going to pick one up, so none of us are ever going to suffer a Gila monster bite, right?
Right.
Right. But if we see someone who is attached to a Gila monster, we will encourage them to go to the hospital, because that is really the only treatment that is appropriate for a Gila monster bite. You do need to be monitored for potentially life-threatening conditions that can develop from a Gila monster bite. Your blood pressure technically could crash. You could go into shock. Your airways could narrow and swell shut. These are all life-threatening situations that you need to be in a hospital environment so that they can manage. And at the very least, they'll manage you for your pain. They're more than happy to use morphine to treat Gila monster bite victims, and that sometimes that's what it takes. So I think at this point, I'd like to take some questions, see if there's anything glaring that I missed. Yes.
What
I saw Gila monsters in Sabino Canyon, they were really shiny and looked wet, but they were coming out of the ground, which I don't think there was any water down there.
So their appearance, their shiny appearance is definitely not due to the fact that they are wet. This animal is very prone to moisture loss. Kind of interesting that they live in the desert with that issue, but that's part of the reason why they spend so much of their time underground. Their skin is, unless you wet them, they're never going to be wet on their own unless something has made them wet. So their skin, despite, you know, maybe not so much with these lights, but it does appear very shiny. That's just the texture of their skin. They're a very dry skinned animal. Yes, way in the back.
What's the life expectancy?
Life expectancy. These animals can live well into their 30s in captivity. So they're pretty long-lived lizards. We'd like to keep them around for a while. And in the wild, it's a little harder to gauge their lifespan because of how secretive they are. So we like to factor in predation, crossing the road, which these guys do not do very well. So we estimate their lifespan at maybe about half of what their captive lifespan would be. And I do mention the road mortality being an issue. These lizards are protected in the state of Arizona. It is illegal to interact with them in any capacity. And the reason why I mentioned the road mortality is because we like to talk with, you know, some people like to ask what are their natural predators, and we talk about that, but really the biggest threat facing wild Gila monsters is human development. These animals cannot cross the highway very well, and a lot of development occurs in their habitat and displaces them. And these are not animals that relocate very readily. So that was my sidetrack, but yes.
We saw one in Sabino Canyon a couple years ago, and it was probably about twice that size and much, much fatter. Does that correlate with their age?
Not necessarily. So we're talking about a Gila monster that she saw in the wild that was considerably larger. This is a big boy, but they can get bigger. Record size for Gila monsters are about 2 feet and up to 3 pounds. So he's a little bit shy of that. This is a 2-foot hook. So that kind of gives you an idea. I'm not going to stick it right up next to him.
That was about the size of it, the length.
Yeah. So they do get bigger, and that's pretty rare that they get that big. So you can should have bought a scratcher that day, maybe, or something, to double your luck there. Mm. Yes, sir.
I've heard when they bite, they don't let go.
When they bite, they don't let go. There is some truth to that, and we're going to get him airborne once more so we can see a little bit about the anatomy of his head. See those big bulges in the upper part of his head there, the upper jaw? Those are muscles. The venom delivery system is located in the lower jaw of this animal. Now those muscles in the upper part that are visible there, those allow them to hang on very well when they bite an animal. And they do not have hollow fangs like a rattlesnake. Their venom delivery is a little sloppier. They kind of drool the venom in their bottom jaw, and it has to be chewed into their targeted, what they're seeing as they're defending themselves from. Mm. So in that sense, hanging on is a very real and useful thing that they have in their toolbox, I guess you could say. Sometimes I talk about removal techniques. There's a number of things you could do, but I guess worst case scenario, if you show up to the hospital with a Gila monster still attached to you, you're gonna be spending a lot less time in triage, right? So we're asking about their territory, which we like to refer to it as more of a home range. Territory would be something that they would be actively defending from, for example, another male. So they don't have that specifically, but they do have a home range where, like I said, if they were relocated, you know, miles away from their familiar territory, home range, that their survival rate would be very, very low. So they do have that set area that they're very familiar with and rely on throughout their life. So
if you put one in your yard and the fire department or whatever takes it away, will that Gila monster come back to that yard?
So if you relocate one out of your yard, will it come back? It's possible. Game and Fish does have standards that any agency needs to abide by when they're relocating these animals. They do need to stay within about a mile of where they were found. So that can be pretty tricky with some of the developed areas still having fragments of habitat and wildlife in them. It can be really tricky to, you know, humanely relocate these animals. Because like I said, if you took it 20 miles away to open desert, you're essentially killing them. It's been very well studied and understood that their survival rate is very, very low if they're taken too far. But if you do have a Gila monster in your yard, I would encourage you to call the fire department, and there are other private services as well that offer relocation.
Oh, he's so cute.
Oh, you just touched that.
Wow.
There you go, get it? There you go.
Yeah. Like, that's cool. What do they call these?
This way for you.
Oh,
you
like
back
tongue. What were those beaded areas called again? Those bones?
Those little bones are called osteoderms.
Osteoderm.
Slide backwards. Sometimes if they're agitated, they can, you know, describe alligator rolls. Monsters can do that too. If they're having a bad day on the hook, sometimes they'll tuck their arms and roll around.
Wiggle out.
Yeah.
Wow. Look at this one.
Do you guys have a name for this guy?
This is the one that's second up on the right. No, very bottom right.
Is there a problem with people poaching these animals for their skins?
For various reasons. There's a unfortunate demand in the illegal pet trade for Gila monsters.
Oh, I bet.
So that's part of the reason why they are protected in the state of Arizona, is poaching is definitely recognized as an issue for them. Yes.
Thank you.